Okay, we'll get started. Thank you everyone for joining us today and to the Center for Asian and Pacific Studies, Jeremiah Lecture Fund and the Global Justice Program and the Anthropology Department who all contributed to this event. This is the first of two lectures that Dr. Nam Kim is giving on campus. So if you are able to, we'd love to have you back here in this room or on Zoom at 4 p.m. for his second lecture. But I'm really pleased to be able to welcome him to campus. We actually had originally scheduled this in January, and then we postponed it due to the surge that was taking place. So I'm glad that he was finally able to make it here. Dr. Nam Kim is a professor of anthropology at University of Wisconsin-Madison, and soon to be on his way to being director for the Center for Southeast Asian Studies as well. He received his PhD from the University of Illinois Chicago in 2010, writing his dissertation on the underpinnings of socio-political complexity and civilization in the Red River Valley of Middle Age Vietnam. He actually started doing research in Vietnam in the early 2000s, doing fieldwork at Co Loa starting in 2007. He's also the author of several monographs, including The Origins of Ancient Vietnam, published by Oxford University Press in 2015, and Emergent Warfare in Our Evolutionary Past, which will be the subject of his second talk this afternoon, which he wrote with Mark Kissel and published by Routledge Press in 2018. And just this a few months ago, even has a co-edited volume with Charles Higham on the Oxford Handbook of Early Southeast Asia that was just published. In addition to these books, he's also published extensively on a wide variety of topics, including his work in archaeology, but also topics related to warfare in African Archaeological Review, Journal of Archaeological Research, Asian Perspectives, and he's also published extensively in Vietnamese in the Archaeological Journal of the Vietnam Academy of Social Sciences. His work has been funded by the National Science Foundation, the Woodrow Wilson National Fellowship Foundation, Luce, Henry Luce Foundation, and University of Wisconsin-Madison, among others. In addition to his fieldwork in Vietnam, he's also done World War II MIA recovery mission in France, worked at Maya sites in Mexico and Guatemala, and at a Neolithic linear bound ceramic site in Belgium. On top of his scholarly work, Dr. Kim is a wonderful mentor to graduate and undergraduate students, and he's co-authored a lot of work with his former students. His personal family history in Vietnam and warfare have led him to explore these topics from an archaeological perspective. So his two talks today will be covering these different aspects of his work. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Nam Kim. As I mentioned to the people on Zoom, if you have questions, please post them in the chat box and I can help field them for the Q&A session when we do that after his talk. So I'll hand the floor over to you and thank you, Nam.
Thank you. I don't know if we want to dim at least the,
yeah, I can,
the front maybe. Okay. I don't need light, so
yeah. Okay. Well, we have some from the window.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, Allison. I just want to thank Allison Carter and Thuong Vu and everybody at the Center for Asian Pacific Studies, Department of Anthropology, and this the Global Justice Program. Truly privileged to be here. I know we had originally scheduled for me to come out back in January, and the pandemic being what it is, we had to postpone, but it's great to be here in person. I'm gonna be talking with this first lecture regarding some of my fieldwork, ongoing fieldwork in Vietnam at the site of Co Loa, which is located in the northern part of the country. And this talk will explore not just the archaeology of the site, but its relationship to modern day societies and stakeholders, and what that cultural history means for people, descendant communities within this region. To give you some background, most of you will already be familiar with this time period, but I like to do this to kind of orient ourselves so we know where this cultural history fits in with other histories that many of us are more familiar with. So if we think about what might be going on contemporaneously on the other side of Eurasia, this would be right around the time of the Roman Empire. So if we're looking at the first century BCE, the so-called Ides of March, we know Julius Caesar is alive. And right at the end of that period, we see the kickoff of the Roman imperial period. And what's interesting about this is the Roman view of the various communities around the Mediterranean world and the view of the various societies who were non-speakers of Latin, who were not part of this Roman civilization, viewed as sort of barbarians on the outside, on the fringes of that Mediterranean world. So communities within the Gallic areas, the Celts, and other societies on the outskirts. And if we move across that Eurasian landmass, all the way out to the eastern part of it, if we zoom in on parts of what would become present-day China, we think about this area with that shaded central area, the central plains, we can think about right around the same time period, this is within a century or so, what we see happening with the Romans. We can talk about what's going on here in the central plains with the Warring States period, or the end of the Warring States period, where we start to see a kind of consolidation and the kickoff of an imperial period for early Chinese history. We see the Qin conquest of these various communities. We see various kingdoms subsumed within this larger political entity. I'm sure everyone is familiar with the very famous tomb of the terracotta soldiers and Qin Shi Huangdi, the first emperor of that dynasty. It's not long after this that we see the Han Empire. So within decades, the Han Empire come into the picture and they begin to expand into other areas outside of the former Qin area. They get into areas of northern Vietnam. They expand in other directions as well. And we have an ascribed date from textual accounts about the Han Empire coming into the area that would become northern Vietnam, this area of the Red River Valley and Delta, at an ascribed date of 111 BCE. We have this happening. We have descriptions from various chroniclers, the grand historian for the Han court, Shima Qian, writing about these various areas on the outside, describing, much like the Romans viewed the rest of the world, these barbarians on the outskirts, and in some ways describing communities that were unsophisticated in need of civilizing. This is a kind of common trope when we look at imperial powers. And if we look at this larger map, you can see this area expanding into the Red River Valley, which areas were kind of like located now. We can also see expansion into other areas, into Northeast Asia, for instance, the Korean Peninsula. And these are parts of that barbarian world. And now I've never taken a DNA test or anything like that, but I would assume that if I did, I would have a lot of barbarian ancestry within me because of my heritage. My father is Korean and my mother is Vietnamese. And I actually was born in Saigon. That's me with my mother. And that is taken by my father as we were leaving Saigon. This is April 29th, April 30th. 1975. So those of you that know the history, this is when Saigon falls. This is the end of South Vietnam. And we were actually evacuated by helicopter off of one of the buildings, not that particular building, it's a different one, but much like it, this USAID compound. But we were evacuated, ended up as refugees going across the Pacific, eventually ending up in the United States. I tell this story because, well, for two reasons. One, it is a privilege for me to be able to work in Vietnam now, to be able to go back and work on early history in that country, a place where we, when we left, thought we would never have any connection to. And the other reason I tell this is because my mother's side of the family hails from the northern part of Vietnam. So this is the Ninh Binh province. This is the 1950s. And this is the entire clan. And there's my mother right there. She's probably about 6 or 7 years old at that time. But for her side of the family, the histories that we're going to be talking about were always known. They read about this in textbooks. They read about it growing up in schools. They heard about these legends and folktales regarding some of these early societies within this area of the world and some of the locations, some of those accounts. And that takes us to the next part of the talk. And this would be the story of what some people consider the early parts of quote-unquote Vietnam. Now, this story has to be told in many ways with an intertwining of history with the Chinese. There's a very long and complicated history between the two countries, between those two civilizations as they emerged. And increasingly, archaeology is being drawn into these kinds of conversations. If we think about Vietnamese, quote-unquote Vietnamese civilization, many people talk about the origins going back a couple thousand years. And it starts in that area of northern Vietnam, present-day northern Vietnam. And given its proximity to the Chinese and what we know happening at 111 BCE when the Han Empire comes in, there has to be a consideration of this long-standing relationship. And even interpretations of that cultural history are affected by these relationships. There was a recent op-ed in the New York Times by a researcher who was talking about modern day political relationships and relationships between Vietnam and the United States. But one quote from this I find very interesting, where the quote is that people in Vietnam have been fighting for independence in the shadow of this giant neighbor for many, many years, many thousands of years. And you can see this playing out. So here we have a tapestry. This particular tapestry sits in the quote unquote reunification palaces in Ho Chi Minh City. And depicted on it is imagery related to what's known as the Bun Bun Kingdom, the Hung Kings. According to legend, Vietnamese legend, these are the ancestors, these are the founders of this emerging Viet identity. This hangs prominently within that particular building, and that building itself has very important 20th century historical and political implications. And we know that with this very complicated 20th century history in Vietnam as well, we have French colonial periods, we have Japanese arrival, we have World War II, we have independence, we have civil war, all of this happening. And in 1945, Ho Chi Minh himself gave an independence speech, and he invokes this deeper history. He talks about the Hung Kings and how everyone is sort of descended, that there's an obligation to go back to those older kingdoms and to live up to those standards. That imagery and that kind of idea gets invoked multiple times throughout this new independent period. And what they're talking about is this area of the world here. So this is now getting into that early history. When people reconstruct that early cultural history of Vietnam, we're really focused on the northern area, so this Red River Valley. What we see with the rest of the modern day, present day borders, a lot of that is within the last several centuries that get added to this nation state of Vietnam. But most people talk about that northern area as the crucible. And our knowledge of that area comes to us from a mix of text, of legend, of folktales, and increasingly of the material record, all combining to give us ideas about that very interesting period, especially within the first millennium BCE, leading up to the arrival of the Han Empire. And we have tales regarding kingdoms like the Bun Lung Kingdom that I mentioned just earlier, as well as what's known as the Olak Kingdom. And the archaeology also tells us about various archaeological cultures that we can identify, material assemblages and sites located within this area. One of those is what's known as the Dong Son culture. And the Dong Son is very famous for a few different kinds of cultural attributes and practices, one of which is boat coffin burials that we see scattered throughout parts of northern Vietnam. This is one of the more famous ones. This is a Viet Cay burial. This was uncovered in the 1960s. And this is, here's a reconstruction of that burial context and some of the materials that come out of it. Very sophisticated bronzes. This is a sort of peak period for bronze production, which had been happening for several centuries leading up to the Dong Son period. But it's within that that we start to see iconographic kinds of materials representative of this part of the world. And the Dong Son is famous as this late prehistoric period as part of the Vietnamese, an emerging Vietnamese identity. There are over 100 different sites that have been identified in the various areas of what's known as Bac Bo, this northern part of Vietnam. We're looking at wet rice farming communities. We start to see elements of social differentiation from some of the burials, some individuals with more material wealth than others. And we see very sophisticated kinds of bronze work as well. So this is the archaeological picture that we have. And there's, and I won't go into too much detail about this, but there's been a healthy interest in the archaeological material and how it might relate to some of those kingdoms that have been described. But we see these materials, the bronzes, for various kinds of implements and tools and ceremonial functions. We also see iconographic depictions on them. The most famous and iconic version of these bronzes would be the drum. So the Dong Son bronze drum, also known as the Heger 1 type in the classification system, have been found in very high concentrations in different parts of Vietnam, especially in the northern part. And you can see some of the specimens that sit today at the National Museum in Hanoi. Here's an example of one. This particular one is one of the finest specimens. This was uncovered at the site of Co Loa, which we'll be talking about today, back in the early 1980s. And it's been estimated that anywhere from 1,000 to 7,000 kilograms of crude ore material would have been used to produce this particular specimen. And if we look at the tympanum just for a second, and we look at some of the designs and the motifs, you can make out the star shape in the middle, these bands showing various motifs, including this crane-like motif, this bird. I was in Vietnam a few years ago, in the city of Thanh Hoa, and driving into the city, this is what you see from the highway. So if you make this out, right in the middle, you have a replica of that bronze structure. Then you have that bird crane motif in this kind of monumental construction. This is symbolic of what people think about when they look at the early parts of Vietnamese culture and history. You see it in these kinds of monuments. You can see it on tea, for instance, you can see the tympanum on these feathered headdresses associated with Dong Son culture. It's significant because this is the last prehistoric culture, archaeological culture, in this area before the Han arrived. The reason that's important is because once the Han Empire comes into this part of the world, there's a Sinitic presence that's there for about 1,000 years. They call it the Sinitic domination periods. So for 1,000 years, you have this kind of intermixing of worlds. And so a lot of people look at this time period as very important for a pre-colonial, pre-imperial period. So here's a satellite photo showing us this part of the world. You can see the Red River itself starts up in the northwest in areas of the Yunnan province of China. So it comes down about 1,200 kilometers before reaching the Gulf. City of Hanoi is located right there within that delta. And the site of Co Loa is also within this delta as well. So this is where I've been doing field work with my colleagues in Vietnam going back several years now. And if we zoom in a little bit more, I like this image to show us. We have this area of Hanoi. We have the Thang Long Citadel, which was the capital in the last several centuries. And I don't know if you can see it, but this is a game I like to play with people to spot the archaeological site. It kind of blends into the environment, but if you direct your attention up towards the north, that's where the Co Loa site is located. And I like showing this image because for me, it's fascinating to think about the cultural history here. We're looking at a location that is the center of political power that goes back thousands of years. If you consider the emergence of this very early political capital, and this is what I think about when I think about the functions of Co Loa and all the changes that happened here right through the present time. Like this a very interesting geographic locus for political power. If we think about this site itself, if I'm not mistaken, this is where we are now. Maybe this looks familiar to you. We're in that area. So right around the same scale, we have the Co Loa site. And I have a few images to give us some sense of scale and size. Here's an image of Central Park in Manhattan, same scale. The Great Pyramid, and this area of the Nile Delta and Co Loa as well. Some of you in this room are very familiar with this next area. This is also in Southeast Asia in Cambodia, and that's Angkor Wat. And actually, before I show Co Loa, I have a different image that I wanted to share. I don't know if Dr. Carter remembers this, but that is Dr. Carter at Angkor Wat, or right on the outskirts. So this was back at the last IPA conference in 2014, IPPA. I snapped that photo. I don't know if you've ever seen that photograph, but now you know that Dr. Carter is doing field work and also showing us around the site. But here we have Co Loa as well. And what's interesting to me is the size of Co Loa. We're looking at something that is about 400 to 600 hectares in size. And if we consider that in terms of other kinds of analogies, that's 1,100 football fields. For this time period, for prehistoric Southeast Asia, this may be the largest settlement that we can point to. We see other kinds of moated sites in areas of Southeast Asia within that first millennium BCE, but they tend to be a lot smaller in size. We have similar kinds of earthwork constructions, various kinds of water management designs, but we don't approach anything of this size and scale until later. So examples from the first millennium, for instance, we start to see other kinds of examples. So in terms of scale, we're looking at, you can make out from these satellite images, three earthen enclosures very clearly. This is the inner wall, and that's roughly rectangular in shape, punctuated by some bastions. This is about 1.65 kilometers in its perimeter. Then you have the middle wall, which is about 6.5 kilometers around in this kind of irregular shape. And then the outermost wall is around 8 kilometers around. In some places, the walls stand up to 10 meters in height, maybe about 30 meters wide at the base. And they have exterior ditches or moats associated with them. The suspicion is that with these three enclosures, we're looking at about 1 to 2 million cubic meters of earthen material associated with the construction process. And we still see many parts of the walls still standing today. There are legends that talk about this particular construction process, which I'll get into in just a few minutes. But one thing that I want to point out here as well is, if you look at that area in the center, it is the Co Loa commune, and it is densely populated. We have thousands of residents. So it limits our ability to investigate all areas of interest. So there have been innovative ways for us to try to come up with details or data to help us understand this particular settlement. Now, this particular site being here has been the subject of a lot of debate. Why do we see this here? Since it does seem to be sort of anomalous, and who might have been responsible? What kinds of conditions led to the emergence of this particular place? Maybe you recognize this image. This is my favorite depiction of King Arthur. So this is from Monty Python and the Holy Grail. And I'm not saying that there's any kind of explanation here or connection between King Arthur and Co Loa, but what I am saying is that there is a kind of interesting analogy that we might look at. So we hear of King Arthur in the Arthurian tales describing the source of power for this particular legendary figure, the Lady of the Lake handing Excalibur over to the king. Within the Vietnamese imagination and legendary accounts, we have an individual by the name of An Dinh Vuong, who is purportedly the founding king of the Olac kingdom, this polity, and who used his power to construct this capital city. In fact, the stories tell us that he had advice from this magic turtle that came out of the water, explaining how to construct his capital city, how to construct his defenses, giving him military advice, and one event also giving one of its claws to the king and telling the king to use that claw as the trigger mechanism for a crossbow. And this crossbow would be an implement that would allow him to vanquish his adversaries, allow him to take power. So that's the story. These are the ruins of what's known as Tintagel Castle. This is in the UK. And for some people, this is linked to Arthurian legends and the idea of Camelot, in fact. We don't know a lot of information. There's a very healthy amount of debate about the existence of King Arthur and whether or not Camelot existed as well. However, what I would point out here that the similar kinds of dynamics are at play when we think about Co Loa. We have traditional accounts that come to us. That's one source of information about the Co Loa site and this history. So we have these very colorful tales that describe the existence of this particular kingdom. So when I mentioned that my mother's side of the family, my relatives, had read about this, these are the kinds of stories that they read about in school. This is accepted as conventional historical wisdom, the existence of what's known as the Olac kingdom, emerging during the 3rd century BCE, with this capital city being its seat of power. And according to legend, there weren't three walls, there were actually nine walls in this kind of concentric snail-like structure. It's the snail shape of this spiral that people point to. An Dung Vương comes to power, overthrowing the last dynasty and establishes the Olaw kingdom. Now, some people argue that perhaps we have to take those stories with a grain of salt. Many of those stories were not officially recorded until centuries later. So they may have been folk tales or oral traditions that were documented later on. Some have argued as well that maybe when they were documented centuries later, there might have been some element or some motivation to embellish, maybe even fabricate parts of these stories. If you recall, the Han Empire annexes this area and the Chinese domination periods would endure for about 1,000 years. And so when we see independence in the 10th century, it's after that that we have these courts, the Vietnamese courts that come across with their own writers, their own historians, who then talk about this grand history that rivals that of China's history, that exists well before the Chinese ever came. So there are folks that say, well, maybe there might be political motivations for embellishment as well. So we have those kinds of issues to contend with. The other source of information obviously comes to us from the Chinese themselves. So as I mentioned before, chroniclers from the Han Empire, administrators and others who describe what they see, what they encounter when they come into this region. And for many of them, just like we mentioned before with the Romans, they viewed the barbarians here as being unsophisticated and backwards, in need of civilizing and education, that they had to bring elements of bronze working, of sophisticated governments, of agriculture and so forth, and teach the locals. There's very little direct reference to the site of Co Loa itself. And just like some of the problems that we might say exist for that first source of information, there might be some problems to contend with here as well, right? The imperial power has an incentive or a kind of argument to make to show why it's justified in coming in and civilizing. So maybe there's some imperial bias that we are contending with as well. But the upshot, of course, then, is that we have these the conflicting depictions of early civilization, quote unquote civilization in this area. Is it attributable to the arrival of the Han? Is it something that's native and local and indigenous before the Han? Or perhaps it's maybe some combination of the two. And this is where the archaeology, I think, can make a difference and contribute to these ongoing debates. The textual accounts give us these ideas, but without the material data, it would be hard to kind of resolve some of those ongoing debates. And one crucial question, of course, is the site of Co Loa itself, this massive settlement that sits in this Red River area. Did it come about as a result of the Han, or was it here beforehand? So my colleagues and I have been embarking on research related to the Co Loa site going back to 2005. These debates have been going on for much longer than that. So there was a paper that was written by Steve O'Hara back in 1979, where he describes some of those textual accounts, what the Han encounter when they come into this area. And I just want to highlight a couple of quotes from this particular paper. One, sometimes an old poem can tell you where to dig. But the other is he points out that we need reliable information, data, for the Co Loa site specifically to help us approach and address these questions. And this is a sort of inspiration for the work that we've been doing. I mentioned before that we have limited access to some of those areas of interest in the middle parts of that central inner wall area. So one of the thoughts for my colleagues and I was to use the monumental system of ramparts as a proxy. If we can figure out the construction process and the chronology for that monumental wall system, perhaps that gives us a starting point to start asking and addressing other kinds of questions. And so we have excavated at three different areas of the inner, the middle, and the outer walls. This is going back for the last 15 years or so. And I'll just give you a kind of highlight of some of our findings to give us an idea of the implications. These are composite photographs of the profiles of the middle wall excavation. We're looking at a wall, a portion of the wall that's about 4.5 meters in height, maybe some 25, 26 meters wide. There's an exterior ditch or moat that we also excavated as well. And from it, we could see various kinds of construction sequences. as well as some materials that give us some ideas about chronology. So if we think about this from a very general standpoint, we identified three major periods and very specific phases of construction within them. Our dating comes to us from artifacts in terms of relative dates and the kinds of construction methods that we see, but also from absolute dates. So we have wood charcoal, we have some thermoluminescence analysis as well, giving us ideas about windows of chronology. And I'm going to be focusing on this middle period of phases 2, 3, and 4. That's when we see the bulk of those constructions, the ramparts being built. Now that early period is important as well, and I'll just say something very brief about this. At the lowest levels, above the sterile soil, we have artifacts related to the Dong Sun culture, that culture I outlined at the beginning. We have pottery, as well as charcoal from the Dong Sun culture. And if you recall, what's important about the Dong Sun culture is we have this cultural material all over northern Vietnam during this time period. And this information comes to us and tells us that we have Dong Sun communities that are here before this monumental construction happens. The radiocarbon dates associated with some of those earlier layers give us this window of about 500 to 300,000 BCE. And it's shortly thereafter that we start to see construction of these ramparts. We have a phase 2 piled earth with clumps of clay and soil and other materials. In some places, you can actually still see profile of the blocks of clay, giving us soil material as artifacts. Next, we have phase 3 with very thick layers of what appears to be stamped around earth. And then phase 4, we have more piled earth, but the bulk of our artifacts come from this area as well, from this layer. These would be ceramic roof tiles. And then we have refurbishment periods that seem to be happening after the fact. One of the things that I might point out here as well, look at the top there, see that kind of U shape. That's from the 20th century. That's a slip trench that was dug during 20th century conflict. So probably used as a fortification during war. And we also found, we recovered machine gun casings and other kinds of artifacts closer to the surface. So we have layers and layers of history here. But for us, the most pertinent for this talk would be this middle period. This yielded materials that give us this window of about 300 to 100 calibrated BCE. I want to say something about the roof tiles. So you can see from these photographs that layer of the roof tiles, these fragments, they're in heavier concentration on the interior side. And what's interesting about them is we find them everywhere at Co Loa. Anywhere where you have portions of the ramparts that are collapsing or that people have cut roads through, you can see the same stratigraphic layer of these roof tiles. It's debated why they're here. One obvious possibility is that they form part of a roof-like structure on top of the rampart. But others have argued that perhaps because we didn't find any post holes, maybe they weren't there for any kind of roofing. Maybe it's debris that's intentionally placed here in the construction process to help shore against erosion. The research is still ongoing, but what we can say is those data dovetail very well with some of the other materials that we have, giving us this window of 300 to 100 BCE. But it's also interesting because we find roof tiles only here. At this time period in this part of the world, there are no roof tiles anywhere in Vietnam. We don't see roof tiles until centuries later. The closest analog these roof tiles would have would be parts of China. We see elements of roof-like constructions and these kinds of artifacts in royal capitals of China, which brings up some very interesting questions. Right? I'll get to that in a little bit. The other thing that we see is from excavations in the inner wall area that my colleagues have done, we have evidence of bronze casting furnaces, very sophisticated ones, as well as casting molds for bronze crossbow bolts, the points, as well as trigger mechanisms. Coming from the inner areas. And one might argue that we're looking at elements of monopolized or state-like control over the production of these very specialized implements that are specific attributes potentially of military power. With these data sets, we can revisit some of those bigger questions and talk about the implications. This is a statue that is located at the Co Loa site. And it's a statue of an individual by the name of Co Loa, who was supposedly an advisor to An Dung Vương, to the king. Some have argued that perhaps he is the actual physical human representation of that legendary turtle. Maybe it was him that gave the advice about construction, gave advice about construction or manufacture of weapons technologies like the crossbow. And some have even argued that perhaps he is from the north, bringing in ideas about militarism, about fortification systems from the north, which might explain some of the architectural features we see at Co Loa. Even though the materials predate the arrival of the Han, as I'll talk about in a second, there are clear indications of connections, interactions that are likely happening, maybe some elements of cultural exchange. So if we think about what we see at Co Loa, the scale of construction. For me, the project that would be required to marshal all the resources to control those labor pools would require some kind of centralized plan. So we might make an argument that we're looking at elements of centralized authority that is sustained, that is permanent, and maybe institutionalized, that we have the ability to outfit this labor organization, to control it, to direct it. And we have this kind of pre-planned conception of what that city might look like. For me, the constructions are actually defensive. There are debates about the functions of the walls. Some have argued that perhaps we're looking at elements of water management, flood control, agricultural purposes, and so forth. I don't discount any of those possibilities. But what I do see as well from some of the other architectural clues is a healthy concern over security. I suspect we're looking at defensive features based on some of the other material that we see there. So in conjunction with these other functions, the construction themselves might also indicate a kind of, not only the capacity, but also a kind of communal sense of belonging. Perhaps the construction process or participation in that process might have been part of this larger identity of the society. But all of this, the upshot then, is that we have all this happening, and it appears to have happened before the Han. This is before that ascribed date of 111 BCE. And we know that even after that particular date, the Dongsun materials persist for a couple of centuries. They don't go away. So the Han colonial control probably does not solidify until well after that. So if we think about that, what does that mean for these larger stories, the legends of An Dung Vương, for instance, or the Ola? I find that the materials are very provocative. They're tantalizing to think about. Perhaps they do show some support for the existence of these particular kingdoms, but it's hard to say if those kingdoms actually existed for sure. It depends on who you talk to. My colleagues will tell you that this is sufficient material evidence to support and substantiate the existence of these kingdoms. But what I have issue with is we don't know for sure. Maybe An Dung Vương existed. Maybe An Dung Vương is actually several people all wrapped up into one particular legendary figure. In any case, it tells us that there's more that we need to find out. The other thing we can point to is with the evidence, not just of the rampart construction, but all of the other material data that have been uncovered, we do see something very powerful here. Whether or not the Ola kingdom existed, maybe is besides the point. What we can say confidently is that within this time period, before the Han arrived, there is a very powerful society present here that I refer to as Co Loa polity, that predates the Han arrival, that is connected to earlier cultural sequences and histories within this area, that go back for several centuries. So that notion of the southern barbarians as seen through the eyes of the Han, obviously we can't agree with that, or we shouldn't agree with that. particular kind of picture. We see elements of urbanism and political complexity here in the form of the Dongsun and Co Loa. And whether or not this is imposed or completely independent of, my suspicion is we're looking at a combination. If we think about the location of the Red River and this river functioning as a kind of thoroughfare connecting societies all along, but also if we think about the location of Co Loa along the coastline, it stands to reason that this is a hub of interaction. There's a lot of movement that's happening, especially during the tail end of the Warring States. So during times of conflict, people move. My own family history is a testament to that. People move, and it's very possible that ideas, goods, and people are coming to this area from areas to the north. And then many of those ideas then take hold and mix in with local ideas. So it's quite possible that that's the reason why we see elements of stamped earth, because we know that stamped earth construction methods have been used in parts of China going back thousands of years. We see these kinds of roof tiles being used as well, which is also reminiscent of Sinitic styles of construction of royal cities or elite cities and buildings. So my suspicion is that we're looking at forms of political emulation, that perhaps local strategies of authority and power, of the consolidation or legitimization of power, might have been affected by knowledge of these kinds of foreign exotic symbols of power as well. And perhaps that's at the heart of a lot of the changes that we're seeing here. So what happens here is not happening in a vacuum. There's definitely connections to be considered. We are continuing our field work. And in recent years, we've augmented the work to go beyond just the rampart system, but we're trying to examine more and more of the site itself. And some of the work that I've been doing with my colleagues in Vietnam and colleagues from US has been focused on geophysical investigations. So that's my colleague, Russ Quick. And we've been looking at magnetometry data. We've been surveying different areas. It started a few years ago, ongoing. It's been interrupted by the pandemic. And it's very slow moving because it's just the two of us. And this is a very big site. But we have some early data sets that operates as a kind of proof of concept. So this had not been tried before at the Co Loa site. So we're embarking on this particular set of investigations. And I'll share with you some very brief highlights. So here's one location. This is in the rice paddy field. This is location number 12. We surveyed this particular area and found anomalies under the surface that were interesting to us. So we conducted some test excavations, those two red areas, the rectangular areas, and we found burials. So this had not been tried by our colleagues, and we wanted to show that you can use this kind of method and approach to identify sites of interest. Now these burials date to a much later time period. This would be during the Lay Dynasty, maybe 18th century. But it does show us that we have the potential to identify sites. So even though we can't excavate everywhere, we don't have the resources to do that, perhaps this is a starting point for some of that work. And we're hoping to start complementing some of that work with LIDAR data as well. I don't have time to get into those details, but that's forthcoming. Which takes us to the last part of the talk here. And this is putting this entire set of data into a larger context of national thinking and the national imagination. Maybe you're familiar with this. I was not. So I Googled this. And this is a video game in Vietnam. I don't know if you've heard of Street Fighter or Mortal Kombat, these video games where you can pick somebody to fight. This is a video game where you can choose. And if you look at this individual, you can see the magic crossbow. This is a representation of Anzen Bo. So it tells us about how you can see Anzen Bo within this popular culture perspective. It's invoked in history. It's invoked in textbooks. There are monuments, there are statues, there are stories, there are tales about Anzen Bo, what happens at the fall of his kingdom. There are very sad and tragic parts of the story. Apparently in one version, the reason his kingdom is overtaken is because his daughter had married the prince of a rival kingdom and she inadvertently or maybe intentionally betrayed him and gave the crossbow, the trigger, to that rival king. And that was the lead to the downfall of the Olaw kingdom. But that's part of this national imagination. And if you go to Co Loa today, there's an interpretive center with many of those materials. And there are ceremonies that happen on an annual basis to commemorate that history, the king and the history. I was on the Co Loa Facebook page and they were posting photographs. This is, maybe you can tell, these are representations of those ramparts and it's created by school children. So field trips to the site teach this history even through today. And increasingly the archaeology is being brought into this mix of information that is relayed to various communities in Vietnam. So you have school children being educated, visiting the site, learning about this history. They are given crossbows to test as well and fire. So it commemorates that entire history. And it illustrates too the importance. So if this is still the case now, we can go back, for example, to this particular time period. That's the statue of Ngoquin, who is the first independent king after the end of the Han Sinitic domination periods. The first dynasty that comes to power is headed by Ngoquin. And this is in the 10th century. And according to text, when Ngoquin comes to power, establishes the first independent kingdom, he moves the locus of power away from Hanoi back across the river to the Co Loa site. He chooses that place as his seat of power. And we can speculate about why this happened, but one possibility is perhaps he is invoking that idea of this pre-colonized past, this idea that he and others are the descendants of this glorious period of history. So we can think about commemoration that was likely happening across the centuries of that Sinitic domination period, from those late prehistoric eras right up through this period of independence in the 10th century. And maybe there's a strategy in using some of those materials and symbols. And in that way, that politically, the past lives on. These ceremonies, these rituals that commemorate, these festivals that bring people together, they can bind people and instill this sense of identity, of community and identity. And it says something about preservation and how the archaeological past can be a very important source of cultural capital. The materials, the stories, the landscapes, the sites, all of them, part of this larger body of cultural capital that can be very important for national thinking, the national imagination. It can be very complex. So when we were first excavating at Co Loa, we were visited by political figures, government officials, the former president, Trần Đức Lương of Vietnam, the deputy prime minister and others would come and visit the site and ask us, what are you finding? And I suspect that part of that is motivated by this. Maybe there's a little bit of concern about, well, is the material you find going to suggest that Co Loa is a byproduct of the Han arrival? Right? Is this going to change the national narrative, the meta-narrative? But there was a healthy amount of interest from the political side, as well as from researchers up and down the country, as well as from the outside the country. But again, showing us this clear connection between the present and the past, and notions of national imagination and pride. There is a conservation agency in Vietnam that oversees two sites. One of the sites is the Co Loa site, one is the Thang Long Citadel in the middle of Hanoi. And if you go to that conservation agency's website, they make it very clear their ideas about this history and the connection of this site to these legendary accounts. They talk very explicitly about An Dương Vương. The former director of the agency, he just left the position a year or so ago, but he had asked if I might write a book detailing some of our field work at Co Loa. And he wrote this foreword. I can show you the translation in English as well. And I just want to highlight a couple of things that he says here. When he talks about the idea of An Dương Vương and selecting Co Loa as his capital, this is a very important history. It's the first state of Vietnam. But he also talks about how he wants this information to be made accessible to the wider lay audience in Vietnam. And it, to me, this is an interesting model because, as I've mentioned, I don't quite go so far as to claim that the materials support the existence of that kingdom. He has no issue making that claim. But we, even though we might have different kinds of outcomes in our work, different perspectives, we all recognize the importance of this knowledge production process. This idea about who actually has a claim on that task, on ownership of the materials, on access to the materials, and on the production of the knowledge that gets disseminated, right? The kinds of functions and purposes. It's not an easy process, it's a very complicated one, and it's tied to our own sorts of professional hangups as well within archaeology, within Western archaeology, that's been very closely tied to colonization as well. There is this push with decolonization. And in my mind, it's a sort of de-exoticization as well, to bring the production of that knowledge back into these communities, but then to incorporate all forms of knowledge in that larger discussion. So it's not just the material data, but we also have to think about the oral traditions, the folk tales as well, as possible sources of information, and to kind of evaluate everything on their own terms. So that's something that I'm hoping, as we continue more and more of this work, we are able to engage with more communities that perhaps we can learn from how others are doing this kind of work in other parts of the world, other regions as well. I'm going to end here, and I just want to acknowledge all of my collaborators and funders for their help in this process, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
So, I'll stand up here so the people on sure. Zoom can hear. So I'll just say, if you're on Zoom and you have any questions, please enter them into the chat box, and then I'll relay them to Dr. Kim. And you can also take questions from people in the room. And then I was just going to ask, like, if you could restate their questions so people on Zoom could hear what they're asking.
Sure.
Since yeah. I think from the audience, it'll be harder.
I'd be happy to do that.
There's a question on the chat. So Damien was asking, you briefly mentioned LIDAR for future research and plans in the works. So he's just wondering, are there plans regarding the exploration of regional settlement patterns and using these large scale in the Red River Plain and large scale Dongsan to augment your understanding of the prehistory of Co Loa?
Yes, there are plans on all of those fronts. The LIDAR data can be very interesting for us. We have access to preliminary data sets just for that area, so not the entire region. I can't share too much yet about that, but it is giving us indications that perhaps some of those legendary accounts might actually be true, that there are other walls associated with the entire complex that people have not identified, and perhaps we can see in some of the LIDAR data. The other part of that question, I think that there would be very interesting insights to examine settlements related to the Dongsan culture all across northern Vietnam and how it might relate to this particular example. It is very anomalous. It is much bigger in scale than all of the other Dongsan era sites. So I think there's something very specific going on related to what we might see happening with the north. But there's no question that there's a relationship with the wider region. So that would be something to explore further as well. Yeah. There are two questions.
So I have a very basic question. I mean, a very basic one. As you discussed the prehistorical Vietnamese settlements, right? And so the question has to, of course, historical referring to written language, right? And so my question is, of course, on the West, you have the Brahmi Indic languages, and on the East, you've got Chinese written language literally on characters, right? So I guess my first question is whether within Southeast Asia generally, and then of course, not specifically, whether there was any archaeologically, any kind of written accounts in any way that don't involve either of those two language sets.
Yeah. So I'm going to paraphrase for the Zoom. You're asking about potential language that's specific to the locality. written forms.
Vietnam, right. Generally that, in terms of a notion of a big prehistory.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there is no writing here. We don't see anything until after the Han period. We see the adoption of Han writing systems. We can point to some of the iconographic depictions as perhaps forms of communication. Maybe there's a sort of vocabulary that we can make out that is sort of shared across the region. There are linguistic reconstructions that are ongoing that give us some clues about the kinds of ethno-linguistic identities that may have existed. But all of that is up for debate.
Yeah.
I can't tell you what languages were being spoken here. I know from the material record, the kinds of material assemblages, the kinds of cultural practices, wet rice, bronze working, et cetera, but what they viewed as their own identity, what kinds of languages were being spoken, that's difficult to say. There are folks, I have colleagues like Mark Aldis at Montgomery College who are working on these linguistic reconstructions that can complement the material and textual record. But all of that work is very, very new and ongoing.
And maybe next to that a little bit, you talked about the regionality for the Han imperial domination. Would Nanyue, for example, be one example of that? Because they're very much in the exact,
yes,
very much bordering one another. Is there a kind of discussion about how there's a kind of intercultural exchange between them?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I didn't get into it, but there are clearly connections between what's happening in southeastern China as well as northern Vietnam. We can, and that the roof tiles is one example of that. That's one category of materials. We see the same kinds of use of roof tiles in architectural features in parts of southeastern China. The accounts, the legends talk about this rival kingdom that would be associated with in Vietnam, it's Nam Viet. And there are, I think, more accounts to describe that history. So we can start to stitch some of these knowledge sets together, these data sets. One of the reasons why I say Co Loa policy, and I don't get into specific political designation, because it is possible, if some of those accounts are true, that some of the constructions may be attributable to the arrival of this foreign power. Maybe it's the Han, maybe it's Nanyue, maybe it's others. There are various potential entities and players. And without that kind of finer grain detail in the material record, it would be difficult to say for sure. So for me, it's sort of speculative, but I would agree. I think there are connections. There are hints of it, clearly, in the material record and the textual. I'm not confident enough to say that we're at a point where we can fully flesh out all of that.
Yeah, I guess in the way I'm thinking of it, of course, non-Ulay are also southern barbarians, right? Everyone
yes,
south
that's
of
right.
Southern barbarians. So, there's a sort of a regional kind of, let's say, sort of barbarian different settlements as opposed to them being Han civilizing.
Right. I would quite agree. I think what we see now is very simplistic. We say China and Vietnam, but these are accidents in history. These are modern day, appellations and boundaries. What was happening 2000 years ago? It's very possible that we have a band of other kinds of ethnolinguistic groups that maybe are very closely tied to one another and affiliated and exchanging people and ideas and material that don't get reflected in China or Vietnam today, but they exist. And the remains of their livelihoods and their lifeways, they are in the record. Yeah. So I think it's very interesting to contemplate. Thank you. Yes?
Well, it was a wonderful talk. I really learned a lot.
Thank you.
Wow, so interesting, and the way you presented it too. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, it's, I learned a lot about presentation too. but I have a couple of questions. The first question is about the King Andean himself.
Yes.
And if I remember correctly, there's written source that he came from somewhere, and maybe from Pope, right, from southwestern China.
Yeah.
And so did you find evidence of him being probably not you look at the builder of this wall city.
I'll repeat that again. So the question regarding An Dinh Vương and his potential arrival from areas to the north. We don't find anything directly attributable to that or directly related to him as a person and his potential arrival. Yeah, I think I recall from my understanding of the text, there are descriptions that perhaps he does come in from the north and perhaps at the head of an army. In some accounts, I think he comes in at the head of tens of thousands of soldiers and then sets up here his kingdom. Whether or not that happens is difficult to say, but there are tantalizing clues. So one of the clues is the Vietnamese did some early kinds of environmental reconstruction for that time period. This was back in the 1970s. This was a paper that was published in the flagship journal that talked about how the environment likely changes very dramatically when the walls start getting constructed. And that it goes from heavily wooded areas to very clear agricultural areas. If that's accurate, and I don't know if it is or not, there has to be more work that's done on this. But if it's accurate, it suggests that perhaps you have a very large labor force all of a sudden transforming the landscape very quickly. It could be related to the arrival of a very large group of people or the construction of a social structure that enables that to happen. The presence of these Sinitic kinds of construction methods and artifacts, crossbow technology as well, all suggest connections to the north. So it could be that, I mentioned the turtle, I mentioned Co Loa. It could be that An Dinh Vương himself is from the north and is bringing knowledge of these kinds of practices here as well. That's all on the table, that's all possible. I cannot distinguish between these scenarios, but I think there might be something to those stories. We can find elements of validity potentially within them, or at least areas to start testing further. But yeah, I find it intriguing.
Oh yeah, thanks. The second question is about the wall structure.
Yes.
Right? And I wonder if you see kind of, you know, similar structure in southeastern China, southwestern China. So how my question is about how Co Loa is connected to the bigger area that later will become, you know, under Han rule, right?
Yeah.
So like in Pan Yu, you know, under Nan Yue, do you see the any left remaining of that ramparts, those walls and so on?
There are sites, settlements in those areas in the north that have rammed earth, that have these kinds of construction principles for cities. The key difference that I see is with Co Loa, you have that rectangle in the middle, but the other walls are very irregular in their shape, their morphology. That seems to deviate from what we see in ancient China. Many of the ancient cities in China tend to be these rectilinear forms, which is very different than what we see at Co Loa. That's why some people speculated before we did these excavations. They said, well, it could be that Co Loa is Chinese because of that rectangle in the middle. Or maybe that was constructed later than the other portions. Perhaps that's after the Han period begins. Our research suggests that they were contemporaneous, that they were built within one time period, but that doesn't mean that there is no connection. Ultimately, what we see here is very anomalous. We don't find big settlements like that elsewhere in Vietnam until later, or elsewhere in Southeast Asia until later. And we don't see the same kinds of cities in parts of southern or southeastern China or southwestern China that look like Co Loa. So it is kind of a hybrid in a way between these two worlds, which makes it a very interesting case.
And the final question is about the purpose of the walls.
Yes.
So they serve defensive purpose as we. And so, is there any way for you to kind of guess where the end, you know, from which direction the enemy comes from, either from the river up or
right
from the mountain down? Or from,
yeah,
you know.
So there are a couple of things I can say about this. I hinted at this before, and just to repeat the question, we're talking about the functions of the walls and the potential threats that they might be directed against. The initial interpretations for some people is that these are not defensive, that they perhaps they're for flood control, for irrigation purposes, other kinds of functions. So we've done a lot of investigation to try to answer that question. My colleagues and I suspect it is defensive, at least that's one of the primary functions, because of certain elements, baffling of the gates, the main gates, the presence of bastions, the presence of mounds at regularly spaced intervals along the tops of the ramparts, suggesting that maybe we're looking at the base of watchtowers. So all that in conjunction tells us probably defensive. The other thing that tells us it could be defensive is when we look at Dong Son iconography, a lot of that iconography shows us warriors on boats with weapons, sometimes with captives. If that's accurate and it's illustrating relationships that might be happening throughout the entire region of Bakbo during those centuries, it's quite possible that you have a host of different societies that occasionally compete and engage in group violence, intergroup violence. So it stands to reason that warfare is not completely out of the picture, right? So defensive features make sense. The only thing about that though is if you think about the scale of those constructions, probably the scale of the threat, the nature of the threat is very different. It's not local. My suspicion is that they're building defenses with some other threat in mind. I think they're looking north. I think they're worried about what's happening in China with the end of the warring states period, with people moving around and people maybe setting up their own kingdoms in different places. Perhaps there is a healthy fear, and that's, you don't build constructions like this unless you have a healthy amount of concern, especially if you're devoting all those resources. It's not just building it one time, you have to maintain it over generations. Otherwise it's a waste of time and effort. So I think that they are looking northward. You mentioned the direction that threats might be coming. I think the river might have been playing a role, because one of the areas that we investigated has a very commanding view of, if you think about the local water system, it's hard to see here. There's a water, the ancient Huangzhang River, connected to the Red River, but it comes in from the west side of the site into the southern entrance. There is an area that with commanding views. If there were ships coming in, you can see them from this area. You could fire upon them if you wanted to. So those are the kinds of clues that we can talk about. That might have been too much information.
Oh, no, I love it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, I think we're about at the end of our time.
Okay.
We have here, so we'll wrap up now, but please come back at 4 o'clock for part two of your lecture series here. And thank you again.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
No, I didn't write letters here, so I actually.